just behind the first baseline and steadily streams out towards left field. Just a perfect day for a gathered and a great American pastime. Glad you could all come out. It's the legendary Crimson Knights of Lake Avalon doing battle with the ruffians of Sam's Remains. The players are taking the field now, and we're just waiting for the pitcher to warm up. 10 dandies in his short career and proven to become an intricate part of this legendary organization. The ruffians are suited in their standard pinstripes, while the players of Lake Avalon sport a throwback look to their first season in the league. As the story goes, the late Sherman Lockwood, Knights owner and former mayor of Watertown, was so penniless when he started up his Knights in red that he couldn't put in for an order with the tailor for their uniforms on time. So he lobbied with the league and negotiated a deal that would allow them to start their first 10 games without the standard league attire, so long as they all matched. The guys got together and decided to brandish their basic school dress, sweater vest, slacks, and a standard cap. It wasn't fancy, but it sufficed. Well, Milcox tips his hat to signal that he's ready and takes his position on the mound. And it's Bucky Fontaine who leads it off. Bucky steps up to the plate with his patented ritual, circles it three times before digging in.
Play ball!
And this one's on the way. Milcox wastes no time and delivers the first pitch. Bucky takes that one at the knees right down the middle, strike one. Homer Kanderbaum catching for the rookie stud this afternoon. He lobs the ball back to Milcox, who quickly takes a sign from the all-star catcher from Michigan and delivers the pitch. Strike two, a real smoker. Milcox wastes no time and makes his attack, and he presently has Fontaine behind in the count. Incidentally, many out-of-towners don't know this, such as the fine folks who came in today all the way from Texas, but Michiganders know it all too well. Lake Avalon is synonymous with baseball, having a love affair with the great American game that began all the way back in the 1880s, still thriving to this very day. In fact, their little Titans made a heck of a run for the state championship last season, falling short by one game to their rivals out in Caulfield. Now Milcox throws one low and in the dirt, but Kanderbaum was there to smother it up. Count on Fontaine is now a ball and two strikes. I talked to the rookie pitcher a few days ago, and he said the only thing he hates worse than losing are the flies that seem to swarm about Redwood Field amid the dog days of summer. Milcox takes a sign now from Kanderbaum, seems happy with the call. There's the windup in the pitch, veering low and outside. Bucky swings anyway, putting some reach on his slice and makes contact. It's a high tower and hit soaring way back, and that ball ended up somewhere in Timbuktu. Home run, he just murdered that ball, smacked the casing clean off it. That marks Bucky's 25th home run of the season, an all-time high for the veteran from Nebraska. Look at him smile as he rounds the bases. Milcox not happy about that one. Definitely a pitch he'd like to have back. The Gator Tram, who was on fire straight out of training camp, but he's cooled down as of late. 0-15 in his last 7 games. I had a chance to talk to him earlier today, and he said he's just waiting for the one that looks right. Maybe Milcox will give him the one that's gotten away. We'll have to wait and see. But not too long, he swings at the first pitch, a heater low and inside, and that ball launched straight up about 10 stories right off the hand of the man from Florida, who, according to his teammates, never goes into rest. He knows he's out, throwing his bat down with a heap of frustration. He comes down just over first base and is flagged there by five-time Golden Glove winner Dale Whitaker, who easily puts it to rest. Sorry, Tram, I guess that wasn't the one you were looking for. Whitaker lobs it back to Milcox, who quickly sets up to face his next batter. Now, Milcox is so focused on the game that he rarely takes a moment to himself. He's often compared to an old gunslinger from the old West, and more often than not, beats his opponents to the proverbial Main Street to show down, and it's Mookie Lords who will meet him at high noon this time. Now, Lords is not a great hitter, but his size makes it difficult for a pitcher to adequately place the strike zone on him. So he walks more often than not to mention the fact that he's got more stolen bases than the James Gang head train robberies. Milcox sizes him up, taking especially long to nod off a pitch sign to Candor Bomb, at least for a pitcher who's as rhythmic as he is. Yeah, they seem to have agreed on something now, and Milcox winds up and fires away. Up way high, Canderbaum had to stand up and leap for that one. Ball one. Milcox shakes that one off, takes his gangly yet intimidating stance on the mound, and peeps out from under the brim of his hat like a predator stalking his next kill. He takes a sign now from Canderbaum and delivers it a tad low right over the plate. The umpire says it's a ball, and Milcox is not happy with the call. You can nearly sense the arrogance of Lords permeating on that field right now. He thinks he's going to get another freebie to first base to visit Whitaker. Let's see if Milcox accommodates him. There's the pitch just outside home plate. Now, Milcox seems to have taken exception to that call and begins to stride towards the batter's cage. Ganderbaum charges out to intercept his friend, and the two share a few muttering words. Milcox barks out towards the direction of Lords and the umpire. I'm not sure who those words were intended for. They weren't kind and poetic, one can be sure of that. Things seem to have settled down now. Milcox takes his position back at the top of Redwood's mound. He stares down Lords for a 1,000 count and fires that one in the dirt.
Four.
He walked him. No question about that one. Lord smirks as he takes his base, refraining from nagging on Milcox with any derogatory remarks. And it looks like he'll meet Whitaker without any unpleasantries to ensue. Good thing. No sense making a mountain out of a molehill. I mean, it's good to see good old-fashioned rivalry in baseball, so long as it all remains in good fun. Unhappy tolls thus far for Milcox this sunny afternoon, at least not the kind that the Knights in red have come to rely on from their young stud. And that'll bring up Kevin the Calm Johnson. Now, Johnson's the big gun for Sam's remains, and he has that look in his eyes right now. You know, the kind that makes pitchers shudder and baseball fans anticipate a souvenir ball for their mantles. He steps up and is greeted by a roar of jeers. They call him the man you love to hate. He takes a phantom swing or two and reaches way back. Milcox studies Kong, shooting down Canderbaum's first few signs. Now he's ready now, winds up and sends in a fastball just over the inside corner of the plate, strike one. Kong disagrees with the call, but doesn't make a fuss over it. The ball shot back out towards the mound, and everyone goes back to business. 88 degrees this afternoon, low humidity, but the steady breeze streaming out towards left field just makes playing conditions superlative. Milcox 0-1 pitch bounces in the dirt and gets away from Canderbaum. Lords takes off towards second, and he makes that stretch and a hop, skip, and a jump. Canderbaum holds on to the ball, just a textbook steal from Mookie Lords, and that'll make his 17th stolen base this season. Milcox kicks the dirt and is not happy with his performance this afternoon. By the looks of it, he wants to get out of this first inning and in a hurry. Canderbaum runs the ball out to him in the two conference. The Great Lakes Bomber is likely telling the young pitcher to just calm down and steady himself. Milcox seems to agree with his catcher's counseling, and he takes the ball with an earnest nod. Canderbaum resumes his crouch, and Milcox is ready. He fires his 1-1 pitch in on a 6-3 slugger from Texas who stings it with some pepper, but it bounces just foul down the first base line, and it listlessly rolls over in the direction of an eager fan. It comes to a lazy rest at his feet. Whitaker trots over to retrieve the ball, stops just shy of the sideline fan, and gestures for him to toss the ball back into the game. He's just a ripe old chap, and not too much so to prevent him from enjoying a good old-fashioned game of baseball. The seasoned fella seems stunned by the invite from Whitaker to pitch the ball back in, and I can't say I blame it. In all my years of broadcasting from my booth in this sleepy city by the water, I've never seen such a gesture offered up to a fan. Whitaker coaches him, suggesting that he just simply pick it up and toss it under. No shame in that.
Shortstop Shea McGraw
swears by the underhand toss religiously in his bang-bang double play maneuver. And the fan obliges Whitaker's request, tossing the ball effortlessly back into the glove of the first base all-star, proving that you're never too young to have fun playing ball. The old fella grins. That just must have made his day. Well, what's this? Whitaker's... Yes, he is. Whitaker is waving him into the diamond. It looks like he's inviting him in to join the game. Well, he is. In fact, it looks unanimous.
Every player on the field, from Wilcox to Candenbaum to Whitaker to second baseman Thad Durbin, they're all waving him in.
And would you look at this? Tom Johnson is actually relinquishing his back to him. They want the old man to try his hands at the plate. Now, I have seen unique things transpire in the game of baseball, but nothing quite as odd as this. They are literally laying out the red carpet for this seasoned chap like he's a celebrity. But the old-timer is playing hard to get. A tad bashful, I presume, but the guys on the field ain't gonna resume the action till their fan takes a swing or two from Milcox. They are just insisting the old-timer takes to the plate. And what do you know? He does. He shuffles on over towards Kong, who hands his killer club over to the elderly fella in gentleman fashion. And the seasoned fan takes the plate, digging in with the stance of an old pro. Milcox tips his hat at the fella, and the old-timer nods. Milcox now winds up and fires in a ball that I could barely see. Gets better and likely had difficulty keeping up with him, too. A swing and a miss puts him behind in the count, 0-1. A candy ball comes up and whispers something in the ear of the old-timer. Pats him once on the arm and lobs the ball back towards the mound. Milcox chuckles and then takes back to his stance, right foot facing out towards the third base line. It's always business with the rookie pitcher from Oklahoma. He takes a sign from Candenbaum, winds up and delivers. The old-timer took that one looking, and it's strike two. A few guys in the field are now coaxing him to swing, telling him not to take a pitch. They don't want him walking. They want the old fella to make contact. Though I highly doubt he has it in him to run fast enough to beat a play made by the likes of McGraw or Durbin or third baseman Lance Jurgens. The ball is back with Milcox now, and the old-timer steps back, taking a long look around the field. He shoots out a grin and then steps back in, digs in and opens his peepers with that look. You know, the one that makes pitchers shudder and baseball fans anticipate that something special is about to happen. There's about a mile now between Lords and second base. He's just itching to get home. Let's see if the old-timer has it in him to get him there. Milcox takes a sign. He's ready. There's the windup and the pitch. The old-timer swings in perfect form and makes contact. It's a sloppy chopper up the middle. Durbin's there to intercept, but it gets away from him, bouncing straight back out towards center fielder Dylan Bailey. Bailey charges in and lords round third, streaking home, full speed ahead. The old-timer hobbles to the best of his ability towards first base, guarded diligently. Bailey scoops it up and fires it towards the best glove in the field, but he threw it with a bit too much zip and it wildly screams over the head of the all-star first baseman, who runs after it with a hint of frustration, taking form. The old-timer is in safe, sticks the base with some gusto, and continues on. Lord's made it all the way home with time to spare and is greeted there by a happy Tom Johnson. And they begin to rally their new teammate home as well. He gains speed on his way to second. Whitaker throws the ball to third, trapping the old-timer now with nowhere else to go. He's in for a double by way of two unlikely errors, but what's this? The old-timer blows right past Durbin, charging full speed in the direction of Lance Jurgens. The third baseman steps forward to cut him off, gesturing towards Durbin as though he's going to catch him in a good old-fashioned pickup. And the ball gets away from him, trickling back towards Goldie Russell. The old-timer keeps on rounding third, heading home, and he charges the home stretch with great form and great determination. Russell pitches in a cannon from left field. Kinderbone's there to make the catch. He leans in to make the tag. The old-timer smashes into him. The two topple over one another. Kinderbone hits the ground like a ton of bricks. The ball's free. The ball's free. And the old-timer tags the base. He's in safe. Standing up, it's an inside the park home run. What do you know? The crowd couldn't be more happy for him. Just listen to the buzz. Both the Crimson Knights and the Ruffians of San Germain sharing the accolades. And the old timer, through a series of mishaps, managed to find his way all the way back to where he started. Welcome home, sport. Welcome home. Been waiting for you.
Hey, Rook. Don't take too long, okay?
Hey, come on! The girls are waiting!